How's your lumbar? Is that good?
That's bad.
Fishing at all?
It's windy.
It's really windy.
I wanted to go out before the 31st. Yeah, I got proposed on the 31st. So. I don't want to snap my boat in half.
It's only a boat.
You don't have to go out on a boat.
Yeah, take a paddle board.
What do you mean? Like your job.
Fish from the shore.
To get gaggers, you do. I've gone out in the river a couple times and turned some lures around for maybe an hour.
Really?
Ahead of time. But actual fishing, I haven't done since I got back from the East. Yeah, I told my wife the other day, I was like, listen, if I don't go fishing soon, bad thing will happen.
I was just going to say, still looking? I've seen that.
Well, she used to. But ever since the baby, not so much.
Is he?
Yeah.
Say terrible twos. Louise is way worse.
She's way worse.
She loves the boat.
Completely agree.
If she sees me go out on the boat without her, if she's out there, she'll freak out. Because she's not on the boat. I just borrowed my neighbor's kayak to go down the canal. I had a coat cooler floating off the dock. Mm-hmm. And we had one of those really nice kayaks. I had a cooler on the dock. I was like, somebody lost a cooler.
Wait a minute.
Oh, something looks just like mine.
It's my cooler.
So I grabbed the neighbor's kayak to go get it. And the baby was out there with us. She was not having
it. The only kayak?
Yep. So I had to put her on kayak. She didn't want to get off. I was just trying to get the kayak out of the water, trying to take her off. Because I pulled the kayak onto the dock. I just paddled up on the side.
I love that Everest though, where she came out of the basin, come out on the kayak.
4 mile.
It was really cool.
Yeah, for one day.
It was caught on fire last weekend.
Yeah.
Really?
Hard with, YP. And
one day, the storm rolled in. I started paddling back as fast as I can. These winds.
It's not very fast.
No. The one, it was coming towards me. As hard as I can. And I'm still looking at the exact same house next to me. Because it's not good. But by the time I got back home, I couldn't even get myself out of the dock.
You tired?
Oh, it was scary as hell. That was the last time I did that.
There's some storms like that in the Keys. There's some storms like that in the Keys that you get scary. Because around Keys, there's, you can be in a spot where there's nothing for forever, and you're like the tallest thing out there. So, you're just going as fast as you can.
Pretty much.
Yes, sir. Appreciate it.
You wouldn't believe it. And we were going from a storm coming in, and was scary. One guy that was trying not to touch anything.
It's not going to matter.
Yeah, that's what I tried to tell him. It's like, oh, it's
just steering wheel.
I'm like, dude,
you're
not
going to
drive.
You're not
going to
feel it.
You know, I was like,
give me a t-shirt.
And then yeah. The other guy that was on the boat were laughing. It's not going to matter. We get popped. We're not going to know it.
Yes.
You booked up that easy?
Not yet. I got to deal with the border and see what he's going down. It's going to be June again. But minus a bunch of people. Like Anita and David.
What was that? He was fine when you guys were there the first day.
Yeah.
The second day he was even fine. And then it was like a stretch.
Yeah. And
it was
fine.
It was weird.
Yeah.
Completely out.
Hey, Teresa.
Good morning.
See you all.
Hi, guys. I'm confused. He fished 2 days. It was fine. Yeah. Drinking. And then he didn't drink at all. And then he out.
Did you feel him? At nighttime hovering over you?
I thought it was you.
Silly boy, I'm taller than you. This guy would put this shirt. And his fiance, he was smoking. They've been engaged, what, now 6 years?
That's some buffalo.
You like these shoes?
Yeah.
I like that.
He knows how to fish, so
I told you, I wasn't hovering over me last week.
The dolphin are pretty cool. When they're at both dolphins, swarm the boat. But puts these in ass.
No.
Now that I know how to do it.
So one time we go hang out for that guy. I'm trying to run the boat. And we're going offshore. So we're actually be running for a couple hours. Everyone and Jeff here can't stay on their side of the boat to save his life. Yeah, he kept going from one side of the boat to the other.
Who?
Well, you didn't turn around. That's what happens for
you. Once you get a set where people are sitting, you're pretty good. So
the automatic turn. You need to buy the automatic turn.
Oh, that's not normal.
Well, if you're a dog.
What about hanging upside down on the chain top? How about hanging on the chain top and accidentally kicking the spinner out? Is that normal?
Hey, I got to speak.
They sound good?
Yeah.
Are they different than the other one?
Hey, counselor.
How's it going?
See you in 2 weeks.
Sure.
The thing is, it's
what?
It's got a sharp beat on the front. So,
are they the same as
just that little bit of adjustment?
Yeah. They are?
Yeah. The boat.
You said that was my new model.
So,
yeah. checked on his DRs in jail.
Okay.
They responded that they had no records showing any. And then the other is just the same postcard that we had before, which is already, it's already in evidence, the redacted one and the original.
Right.
But we don't remember the number, so we're going to re-enter our copy.
And you know, I wish I had brought the exhibit list. And I think, you know, I should have brought the exhibit list.
I should have brought mine.
One thing I didn't bring.
And I didn't bring my legal pad, which had that.
We have no objection.
Okay, so, thank you.
Which I think you expected, but just to confirm.
Great.
But just to confirm.
Drives.
Thank you.
you're seeing picture right now? Cool. I'm going to move to the other side. Yeah, I changed cables. Because he brought me the longer cable, so I'm going to move to the other side. Cool. I changed all the panels.
Right.
I gotta do it to date mine as well, but I don't have an issue with that.
Okay, because we're parked right by your line trucks.
Oh, okay. So we're probably going to be working here.
Mr. Mummer, you want different labels for it?
I'll put you
labels.
No, it's not there. Just the connection. Oh, that would be wonderful. Just one.
Thank you.
You would think I knew.
Okay.
Is it your position that you want to object to the entire PSI?
Thank you.
All right. I'll allow you to do that. Execution? You got a problem with that? Comes out to $9,000 if you go to the last page.
Please put your people to let the court reporters have access to the database. I have called and I haven't had my phone calls returned because I just really like to have access to the database. No, I don't even know how to do that. I called, but no one returned my call. Guys, all of the clerks in all of the trial courts are very good, but we get home and we're like, and we're doing a transcript 4 months later, so like, I don't remember how to spell that guy's name. I'm gonna ask. And if you've got access to the database, you can go look at the subpoenas and stuff.
I'll get an answer for you and I'll let you know.
Thank you so much, Mr. Teresa. Appreciate it.
See that yellow pad there? Mini?
Thank you.
Mike, how do you feel about the cost of prosecution? Okay. Yeah.
Court will come to order. All rise. Circuit Court in and for Lee County is now in session. The Honorable Judge Bruce Kyle presiding.
Please be seated.
How are you?
Morning.
Okay. Give me one moment.
For the record, both Assistant State Attorneys are present. Defense counsel and Mr. Sievers. State's ready to proceed?
Yes, Your Honor.
Defense is ready?
Yes, sir.
Anything further other than your memorandum of law that the state would like to add at this time?
Your Honor, given that the victim impact statement was already presented, as well as other materials, the state has nothing additional to add at this time.
I will add that I have received the PSI. Have both sides received it?
Yes, sir.
And, Your Honor, the state had brought a copy if the court had not received it.
Got mine right here.
The state also has a cost of prosecution document.
Yes, ma'am, you may approach.
Thank you, Your Honor. And we have presented to the defense a cost of prosecution. We understand they have no objection, Your Honor.
The grand total's at the end?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay. No objection to that amount from the defense?
No, Judge, we just received it this morning. Haven't had an opportunity to go through with a fine-tooth comb, but we have no objection to it.
Okay. So nothing further from the state?
No, Your Honor.
Any objections, additions, or deletions from the PSI?
No, Your Honor.
Okay. Defense?
Yes, Your Honor. Specifically with the PSI, the PSI attaches the original booking narrative. Your Honor, the original booking narrative contains erroneous statements of fact. Additionally, Your Honor, the original booking statement or narrative contains statements of individuals who never testified at the guilty, not guilty phase. Finally, Your Honor, the booking narrative is a police report. Typically, in most trials, police reports are inadmissible. There is a plethora of case law that describes police reports as inherently untrustworthy. Additionally, Your Honor, this particular PSI contains victim impact from Ann Lisa, who, pursuant to Florida statute, is not a victim, as the victim is the next of kin. Your Honor, the next of kin, we assert, would be Ms. Sievers, Dr. Sievers' mother.
Dr. Sievers' daughter, Josephine Carmela Sievers, as well as any direct full sibling. Accordingly, we feel that the victim impact in the PSI is improper, and we object to the PSI on those basis.
Okay. Noted for the record, the PSI is confidential. I'm going to make it a part of the file and have it sealed. And your objection to the booking sheets noted for the record. My sentencing will be based on the evidence presented during the trial, not the booking sheet that's attached. Any other additions, deletions, or objections? Okay. And the recommendation from the department was for the death penalty, I believe, if I remember correctly from looking at it.
That is correct, Your
Honor. The PSI represented that the entire family from the Teresa Sievers side of the family was they were for the death penalty. Is that correct?
We have not had.
The only reason I ask is because that's implied in the PSI, and something different has been stated in the defense's memorandum.
In speaking with the family, we've had no indication that they are not in favor of it at this point in the proceedings, Your Honor. They are, Miss Groves, the mother of Teresa Sievers, is here as well as one of her brothers, if the court would like to inquire.
Well,
or would like me to take a moment to inquire?
I can give you a moment. It was more of a curiosity issue since the statements are in conflict.
Your Honor?
Yes, ma'am.
It is the family's position that the sentence should be left up to the court, and so they do not have a position.
Okay. Just give me one moment. Send it to you.
Thanks.
Okay, so nothing further from the state?
No, Your Honor.
Defense?
Judge, the defense is going to have two exhibits, but could the state and the defense approach?
Sure.
Bench?
Thank you.
request the second chance.
Defense.
Yes, Judge. Defense has three exhibits to enter. First is marked State of Florida versus Mark Sievers, case number 15CF673B, number 1. This was a request made by the defense to the Lee County Sheriff's Office inquiring as to whether Mr. Sievers had any history of any disciplinary reports since he's been incarcerated since February the 26th of 2016. Exhibit 2 is a response from the Lee County Sheriff's Office saying that based upon the information, the Lee County Sheriff's Office has been unable to identify any records that are responsive to a request. So it's our position that Mr. Sievers has received no disciplinary reports whatsoever during his incarceration. Exhibit 3, Judge, is page 1 of it is the cover of a postcard, and page 2 is the postcard itself. We talked about this during the trial. It's from Mr. Sievers' daughter to him. And it expresses her love for him and that in pertinent part, she writes, is it possible they could kill you? I really hope not. Please say no. I love you. I miss you. And there's some other wording there. During the course of the trial, a redacted version of this was entered into evidence as well as the original. Just for the purposes of this hearing, we've made another copy and we should submit that into the record.
Yes, sir. We'll show them admitted, and is that as composite exhibit 1? Or you have it labeled already? 1, 2, and 3. You got it. Oh, yep, they're already marked. We'll show exhibit 1, 2, and 3 from the defense admitted. At this time, would you like some time to talk to your client before we see if he would like to make a statement?
Yes, sir.
Okay. We'll give you like 20 minutes. We'll be in recess. Yes, sir. I'll be back. I won't go far. I have a habit of wandering.
You do it.
What time to start?
That's right. I played last year.
So that one's the best. judge. Want to approach on that now? Judge, we did have an additional exhibit, however, and I believe the state would like to approach on it.
Okay.
Ready. I'll review the document that you've given to me and give the state an opportunity to look at whatever else is coming over from their office. We'll be in recess for the next few moments. Thanks.
said, I have no idea what it is. There's just so many speculations.
Is there anything else going on today in the courthouse, or we're at?
I think there's a couple missing airports going, but nothing else really.
Just everything?
No, actually,
that's what we were doing. I'll do that. I like to say that's what we were doing.
Good. Probably nothing stops that. I'm so glad I don't have to do that stuff. No. It's juvenile occasionally, believe it or not. Not now. If delinquency was still separated from dependency, I would. Because I can't do dependency. I think you have to have a special judge for that. I'm more suited for the delinquency side. And I enjoyed that, actually. But I'll never go back now. Do what? Yeah, they do unify, so they do dependency, the divorces, and they separated them out. Unfortunately, I've seen a lot of them come up through the ranks up here. She's probably thinking the same thing I'm thinking. In misdemeanor, there's how many judges now? 8? I'm thinking I'm 1 of 5, and I'm seeing a ton of the kids I had. And so I'm only getting 20% of them. That means a lot of them are coming up.
She thought about going back, but she didn't want to do them.
Just like me, yeah. I just needed a break. I opted to stay there that second time.
Yeah.
You're still in family?
No, I'm
We're going to go back on record. We have both assistant state attorneys present, both defense counsel and Mr. Sievers. Yes, ma'am.
This is horrible. I need my glasses to find that button. Mark doesn't want to do
ready. Defense, you move in number four.
Yes, Your Honor. May I approach the clerk?
Yes, sir. We'll show it admitted. Without objection, state.
Without objection.
Okay. And that's the statement of Dr. and Ms. Petritis. As to the other statement that's been given to me, we'll go off record again for a few moments to give me a moment to read it first. We'll be in recess. We'll go back on record. Both assistant state attorneys are present, both defense counsel and Mr. Sievers. State.
Your Honor, at this time, if the court would permit, the state would like to in essence, open its portion of this and submit as state's exhibit number one. I've marked it as P1, a victim impact statement. The state is just going to ask the court to read it, which I believe the court has just done, and will not be reading it. The state will not be reading it, nor will any family member be reading it, Your Honor.
Defense.
Objection.
Okay, we'll show it admitted. This is what you want, state. This will be public record, just so you know. I'm just asking.
I think having asked the court to read it, Your Honor, we need to make a record of what the court has read. If we can make it a court record as opposed to a state exhibit, that would be good, but I don't know that we can do that.
I don't think I have the ability to do that.
I don't think you do. I do think that the state would be filing a motion to seal it as confidential.
I don't think I have grounds to do that either, do I?
I also have the email that was sent to the individual who was the Florida Department of Corrections that received this. Again, because the family has invoked Marcy's law, I have a copy of that email that pertained to that victim impact. Do you want to, Your Honor, may I take just a moment to
Sure.
speak with the family?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you for the moment, Your Honor. The state's going to withdraw its request to introduce it as an exhibit.
You know what? I've been thinking about it. Since Marcy's law has been invoked, I think I can seal it. It's up to you.
Your Honor, if it can be sealed, then the state would admit it as an exhibit. But if it cannot be sealed...
Well, I mean, there's identifying...
Yes, there is.
Information about who the victim is, I think I can seal it. I can always, it's, Marcy's law is new enough that occasionally I forget about that. No objection to its admission?
No objection.
I'll seal it.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Yeah. I will note for the record, though, that it is similar in tone and meaning as to the postcard. Anything further from the state?
No, Your Honor.
From the defense?
Judge, if I could just make a brief proffer.
Sure. And before that, too, you're admitting that as states one.
Yes, Your Honor. And I marked it as P1 so that there would be no confusion
states
with
trial, P1.
Sentencing, or other.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Your Honor, during the course of my representation, of Mr. Sievers. I was the attorney who, in addition to handling his criminal case, also handled the dependency case. During the course of the dependency case, I had an opportunity to meet with Mr. Sievers and Dr. Sievers' daughters, Josephine and Carmela. This was when Mr. Sievers was accused of second-degree murder. And it struck me, the first thing they asked was, Mr. Mummert, can they put my father to death for this? And at the time, he was charged with second-degree murder, and the death penalty was not a salient sentence. I said no. And they literally wept with relief. About 3 weeks later, the indictment came forward, and about 45 days after that, the state submitted its notice of intent to seek death. I did not have an opportunity to speak with the girls since then, but again, Your Honor, given my personal interaction with the girls, given the letter that was sent to the court, and given the postcards, there is a very strong indicia that the daughters who are next of kin do not wish for their father to be put to death. Thank you, Your Honor.
Is your client going to make a statement?
Yes, he is, Your
Honor. Okay. Yes, sir. He can do it right there if he'd like, or if you want him at the podium, he can do that, whatever you prefer. Yes, sir. If he needs the use of one of his hands, the bailiffs can take care of that.
Is it okay if I refer to my notes?
Yes, sir, absolutely.
Although a jury found me guilty, I am innocent of all charges, as I have maintained this crime.
Other side at the moment that I found. you need a few more, I'm happy to go to recess if you would like.
I was going to be prepared. Would have made some additional legal argument, but we did want to put on the record certain mitigation that we felt was brought out during the penalty phase hearing. Judge, submit as far as statute mitigation goes, that there's no significant history of prior criminal activity was established, even though on the jury found that no existed. The state conceded during its closing existed, and further in the state's sentencing memorandum 6-3, they further concede that the state did not contest the mitigating circumstances, no significant history, and cannot reject this mitigating circumstance when both the state and the defense conceded to exist. And the state has cited the case of Santos v. State, 629 Southern 2nd, 838, which case I've read as well, and it does, the state is correct. They conceded that mitigating factor should find that. Judge, the defense also presented statutory mitigators that the defendant was in a company committed by another person. Her participation was relatively minor. We asked the court to find that that mitigating circumstance was established. And as far as what we call non-statutory mitigators, or the catch-all, some of those, and this is a not exhaustive list, but we believe that it Mr. Sievers as a father, there was testimony of him being a loving, caring, and excellent father, and that his world revolved around his children. We brought out evidence as far as charity work, that he was involved in the community. We brought out childhood, about his parents having been divorced, spending much of his childhood in another country, that his sister, Stacy Sievers, died from Graves' disease. And his other sister, Jamie Sievers, was unable to attend the penalty phase due to some mental illness issues. Then Mr. Sievers graduated from high school. He went on to college, obtained a bachelor's in psychology, and then his licensed practical nurse degree. He'd always been gainfully employed. As we brought out today, he had no disciplinary issues during the 3+ years that he's been incarcerated. That there were no issues of Mr. Sievers ever in any of his court appearances in front of this honorable court where he acted. That was established that he was deeply into various religious practices, both Judaism and Christianity, and was involved in that with his wife and his children. It was established that Mr. Sievers has the support of his friends and family who have loved him all his life, love him and will love him for the rest of his life and will continue to support him. And as far as Mr. Mummert and I are concerned, he's been an exemplary client who have represented during this case.
Okay. Before issuing the sentence, I'm going to take a brief recess and collect my thoughts. How about what time is it now? 10:30. I'll be back in 15 minutes.
All right.
Thank you. both defense counsel and Mr. Sievers. All right. The jury came back with a recommendation for the death penalty. It's just that it's a recommendation, but I have to give it great weight, which I will do. The state proved one aggravator beyond a reasonable doubt. That is, the capital felony was a homicide and was committed in a cold, calculated, and premeditated manner. Without any pretense of moral or legal justification, I believe the state did meet its burden. I agree with the jury as to that aggravator, that they established that beyond a reasonable doubt. The plan for the murder was well planned out, covered several months, was concealed well with burner phones, as they were called, during the trial. And at no time was the plan stopped at any point by Mr. Sievers, who initiated the plan, as well as there were statements as to anyone else who was with her when the murder occurred would be just collateral damage. And for the record as well, I'll have a more detailed order that's going to follow that I'm going to sign at the conclusion of this hearing as well. As to the aggravator that they the state tried to prove as pecuniary gain, they didn't meet their burden according to the jury. I agree with the jury. I don't think they met their burden with that as well, and I'm not going to consider that in rendering a verdict here today. It seems that the primary motivating factor was custody of the children if there was a pending divorce and or a threat of divorce. As to the mitigating circumstances, all the jury said there were none. I do find that there are at least two mitigating circumstances that I will weigh. The first is the one that the state also agrees with and even told the jury, they said it existed, that the defendant, Mr. Sievers, has no criminal record. He has absolutely no criminal record. And I believe the defense has met their burden of greater weight to that, and I'm going to weigh that in the analysis of his sentence. The second would be the catch-all provision. I believe they've met their burden, and we've added, I think a few things are added to that here today beyond the fact that he had been a good father, had been a good family member, had taken care of sick relatives, had made charitable contributions throughout his life in the community. I will note for the record that he also taught his children their faith, and I will note for the record that his children do not want the death penalty imposed, has been put on the record now with more than one item in evidence at this point. And he was a hands-on, devoted father, and he did help people who were in need. And I will note also that added here today to that section is the fact that he has no disciplinary record in the Lee County Jail during the pendency of this trial and case. These each of these circumstances, and there's the other mitigator argued from the defense that his participation was relatively minor and someone else committed the crime primarily, and that he was a minor participant. I don't think the evidence reflects that, and I think the jury made the right call on that one since they said there were no mitigators. I don't think that's an actual mitigator that's been proved given the sophistication of the offense, how it was planned out. He was a major participant. Weighing each of these, of course, as we've explained to the jury, I weigh it the same way the jury's instructed to weigh it. It's not on the number, it's on the weight as to each. As to each of the mitigators, I give them little weight. As to the aggravator, given the fact pattern that's been presented during the trial, I give that aggravator great weight. And in weighing the two, I'm in the same position as the jurors with that, and I believe the aggravating factor, the weight of it outweighs both mitigators. And as to that, to just make a couple comments about your statements here today, Mr. Sievers, a jury of 12 have found you guilty as charged, so you are guilty. You do get an automatic appeal to the Florida Supreme Court. I'll inform you of that at this point in time as well. And I judge people's actions. I don't judge people's souls. That's for somebody else to do. Sir, I'm going to go ahead and adjudicate you guilty on each count. On the first count, first-degree murder, it's the order of the court that you be sentenced to death, sir. And the second count, conspiracy, I'm going to sentence you to 30 years in prison consecutive to count one. Again, you have an automatic appeal to the state Supreme Court. There's $413 in court costs, $100 cost of prosecution, the standard cost, as well as the total cost of prosecution, which has been agreed to, of $9,287.48. I'll order a reserve on any cost outstanding to the JAC at this point that have been expended on your behalf. If you think this is an illegal sentence, of course, again, you have an automatic right to appeal. You'll get credit for all the time you've served on this case, concurrent with as to all counts. His total credit is
1,408 days
towards this time. And again, I judge people's actions, not their souls. And if I'm wrong, hopefully God will have mercy on both of us. Good luck to you, sir. We'll take your prints and your DNA as well. Nothing further from the state.
Just for the record, have a copy of the criminal punishment score.
Yes, ma'am.
Which I'm submitting to the clerk, Your Honor.
And I'll sign the order today and send it down. Anything else from the defense?
Yes.
And of course, the sentence will be carried out according to the a warrant by the governor at a time and place of his choosing and in any manner that is legal at the time of execution. We're in recess. It's assumed in that, so just put the 9,000.
Okay. And then you ordered in reserve, but didn't get $372.
It's on the JAC. That's the Justice Administration Council. Just put JAC, they'll know. Because he's indigent for costs, so they paid for all the depositions, etc.
Okay. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you. And I didn't say it, and it doesn't have to be on the record. My sympathy to the families and to both sides.
The court now having signed the prints, is the state free to go?
Yes, sir. Thank you. Yes, sir. Oh, you're welcome.